أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ
وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِندِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. With verses from Surah Al-An'am, we will try inshallah ta'ala, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us all and to give us the ability to reflect upon the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be among the people of the Quran, those who listen to the Quran and recite it and memorize it and reflect upon the meanings of it, to act according to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the purpose of the Book of Allah, to act according to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This is the challenge that human beings, they need to face, which basically in this life, either we follow our desires and we have things to pull us towards this, or to follow the revelation from Allah. The revelation from Allah has the truth, the absolute truth. And our desires, sometimes it takes us away from this. So we need to make sure that we follow the truth and we make our desires follow this till we reach our destination, till the final moment of our life. And this is basically the test that we have on the face of earth, and that is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Surah Al-An'am, this surah of the Tawheed, talks about one subject, which is the best subject, which is the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in lordship, in worship, in His names and attributes. Inshallah ta'ala, in this short period of time, in this episode, we'll go through verses number 91 to 93. Three verses, they're a bit lengthy verses, but we'll go through the verses, try to understand what the meanings of them, how can we apply these verses in our lives. And it talks about something with regards to the disbelievers, how the disbelievers, they did not estimate, they did not praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way it ought to be, and underestimating the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, and other verses inshallah ta'ala. So we'll start inshallah ta'ala with verse number 91 from Surah Al-An'am. Verse number 91, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدِرِهِ إِذْ قَالُوا مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَى بَشَرٍ مِّن شَيْءٍ قل من أنزل الكتاب الذي جاء به موسى نورا وهدى للناس تجعلونه قراطيس تبدونها وتخفون كثيرا وعلمتم ما لم تعلموا أنتم ولا آباؤكم قل الله ثم ذرهم في خوضهم يلعبون. Which means, and they did not appraise Allah with true appraisal when they said Allah did not reveal to a human being anything. Say, who revealed the scripture that Musa brought as light and guidance to the people? You, meaning the Jews, make it into pages, disclosing some of it and concealing much. And you were taught that which you knew not. Neither you nor your fathers say, Allah reveal it. Then leave them in their empty discourse, amusing themselves. So this verse, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِ, it's either addressing the Jews, as some said, or the polytheists, the disbelievers among the people of Quraysh. Ibn Kathir and others, they say it's more likely to the people of Mecca, to the people of Quraysh, and the disbelievers in general. And anybody that does not follow the Prophet والسلام, basically fall into this category of evil actions. What is it? وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِ. They did not appraise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way that He ought to be subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of the heavens and the earth. He does not create His creation like this for nothing, for play. There's a great wisdom, there's a great purpose. So when people deny the messengership of the prophets alayhimus salam, they're basically saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them for no reason, or for just amusement, or just, you know, no benefit whatsoever. This by itself negates the fact that they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is for those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Most of the human beings, they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believe in the creator of the heavens and the earth. So how can someone believe in the creator of the heavens and the earth and does not believe in the messengers of Allah? It contradicts one another. They have to, by necessity. Why? Because the creator of the heavens and the earth, he won't create this powerful creation and leave it without a wisdom, without a reason for it to be created. Why we are created, and why there is death, and why there are injustices to be present on the face of earth, and why people can oppress others, and people might have patience, and, you know, the complexity of the life of the human being is in such a way. It is not just created for nothing. And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, he did not leave his creation like this. What is the reality that people need to see in this life? Without making up anything, there are messengers being sent. Is there anything else that people would see that would fulfill the purpose of this life? Or if they say, we appraise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way he ought to be appraised. If someone claims this, then where is on the face of earth that you would see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not leave his creation like this? Otherwise you'll contradict yourself. So what's present on the face of earth is this message from the messengers of Allah. وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِ. Why? إِذْ قَالُوا مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَى بَشَرٍ مِّن شَيْءٍ. Why they did not appraise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way he ought to be appraised, when they said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not brought down anything on any of the human beings whatsoever. That means no revelation whatsoever. No wahy has been brought down to any of the human beings. This is underestimating the power of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to reveal his revelation to a human being, and has to be a human being. And it's mentioned in the beginning of Surah Al-An'am and other surahs of the Quran, that if this revelation from Allah was revealed to an angel, for example, people would say, this is an angel. How can we follow an angel? He's not like us. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this to a human being that has what human beings have, so that they would take him as an example for them to follow. So there has to be some human example. And the best example of all are the messengers of Allah. And the messengers of Allah, the best of all of them is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So human beings, they live their life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them in such a way. Human beings, they don't just take instructions to do things. They have to see an example. They have to see things in practicality for them to be able to follow. That's why one generation after another, they follow one another. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ was sent, and the prophets before him were sent, for people to see the best example that they should follow to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So those who deny the messengership, and that's why one of the pillars of al-Iman is to believe in the messengers of Allah. They did not appraise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way he ought to be subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they said there is no revelation came down to any of the human beings. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his mercy, he responded to this by saying, قُلْ مَنْ أَنزَلَ الْكِتَابَ الَّذِي جَاءَ بِهِ مُوسَى نُورًا وَهُدًى لِلنَّاسِ. Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that's why some said that this verse was revealed with regards to the Jews. Who is the one that brought down the book that Musa alayhi salam came with? Nuran wa hudan linnas, light and guidance to mankind. Taj'alunahu qaratisa tubdunaha wa tukhfuna kathira, which means you make it into pages, disclosing some of it and concealing much. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to them, who's the one that brought this book, At-Tawrah? What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought to Musa alayhi salam is At-Tawrah. So if they believe in At-Tawrah, and they know that the Jews have been revealed to them, to Bani Israel, At-Tawrah, who's the one that brought this book to Musa alayhi salam? And as we know that we believe in the Torah, we believe in the Injil, this is part of the belief, one of the pillars of Al-Iman, is to believe in the books that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed. And what happened to these books before the Quran? That it has been altered, changed. As one of the verses that states this is this verse, تَجْعَلُونَهُ قَرَطِيسَ تُبُدُونَهَا وَتُخْفُونَ كَثِيرًا. First, it was brought down to Musa alayhi salam نُورًا وَهُدًى لِلنَّاسِ, light. And we talked about this concept before, which is so many in the Quran, and the Quran is light. That means the light is needed when a person is in darkness. Otherwise, when it's already light, why would a person need light over light? So that means this life is darknesses. The life that we live in is dark. Dark when it comes to matters of belief, what people perceive in their life, what people think, what people do and act and so on. Everything is total darkness, and that's why people are just leading themselves to their own destruction. Except for those who have light with them. And this light is the revelation from Allah. So this is how we should be as Muslims. We should make the matter very clear to us. Unless you have the light, which is the revelation from Allah, the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, that means a person is leading himself astray. And the more the person holds fast to this light, the more that he will be guided. And that's why people are not on the same level. It's all according to how they are holding fast to the revelation from Allah. So nuran, guidance, light, and wahudan linnas, and guidance for mankind. This is the guidance. There is no other guidance but this guidance. And as we always hear in the beginning, which is the khutbah that the Prophet ﷺ always used to say, وَخَيْرُ الْهَدْيِ هَدْيُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. The best guidance is the guidance of Prophet Muhammad صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. So the book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Musa alayhi salam, the Torah, had light and had guidance to the people. But what did they do to it? تَجْعَلُونَهُ قَرَاطِيسَ تُبُدُونَهَا وَتُخْفُونَ كَثِيرًا. You make it qaratis. Al-qaratis is like pages, as we heard. It's like parts, as Ibn Kathir rahimahullah said. You made it parts, and you would conceal some of it, and you would expose other parts of it. So the people of knowledge among them, they divided the book, the Torah, into pages, into parts, and they would expose some and hide and conceal others according to what is going to bring benefit for them. This is the corruption that happened to the books before by the people in charge to be entrusted by the book, but they betrayed their trust to keep their status, their authority, to please rulers, to whatever reason there is. And this is something that the Quran states clearly. So they would conceal some and they would expose some. And among the ummah of the Prophet والسلام, among some of the people of information, we don't want to say people of knowledge, because the people of knowledge, they fear Allah. So those who would fake knowledge, those who have information, or people would put them in the position of being scholars, some of them, they would hide the truth for whatever personal benefit that they get as a result of this. As that's why the ulama, they say some people of knowledge, when people ask them, they don't want to make the questioner or the people upset. If people are established on something and it's a sinful act, so they don't want to bother them with this. They don't want them, the people, to reject the authority of the people of knowledge. So they would speak, or they would speak lies, and they would hide the truth. They won't say that they are upon haram and sin. They would say, they would approve for them what they're doing of disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on. And this is how the religion changes among the lives of the people. Why? As the people of Bani Israel, they took parts of it. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah, He condemned them and He said, أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Do you believe in some parts of the book and you disbelieve in other parts of the book? And we have to be very careful, because as the Prophet ﷺ said, that a group or some people from my ummah, from the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, would follow the ways of the people of the book before us. So the same thing, the Quran has many things in it, many verses. Some people, they take parts of the Quran and they would apply it in their life, whether it's matters of belief, for example, or if they find themselves able to establish the Salah, they take that and they say that this is definitely, of course, every Muslim should know that the Salah is part of the deen of Al-Islam and the pillars of Al-Islam and so on. But when there is something that makes, or they think it might make their life difficult, so they would conceal it, or don't talk about it, or they would alter the meaning of it. Like, for example, if a person doesn't want to wear the hijab for women, for example, so they would conceal the verses that is present in the Quran that talks about hijab, or alter the meanings of it, or the ayat of the riba, for example, using usury and so on. So this is just an example. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemned them because of this, and He said, وَعُلِّمْتُمْ مَا لَمْ تَعْلَمُوا أَنْتُمْ وَلَا آبَاؤُكُمْ. But we'll continue, inshallah ta'ala, with this verse and the next two verses after the break. So stay with us, inshallah.
يتدبرون القرآن
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Welcome back and still with verse number 91 in Surah Al-An'am. And after we heard that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying about the disbelievers when they did not appraise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way that He ought to be appraised, when they said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not reveal any books to any of the human beings, denying the books of Allah, denying the messengership of Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent messengers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to them, who's the one then that brought down the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a Torah that was revealed to Musa alayhi salam as light and guidance to the people, that you would make them parts, pages, that you would conceal some and expose others and so on. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعُلِّمْتُمْ مَا لَمْ تَعْلَمُوا أَنْتُمْ وَلَا أَبَاؤُكُمْ. And you have been taught what you did not have any knowledge of before, you and your fathers and your forefathers. And you were taught that which you knew not, neither you nor your fathers. This refers to the book of Allah, the Quran, that the Quran informed them of what they didn't know from before. And that's how the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes to clarify things for people. For example, the people of the book, they had disputes about things before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So the Quran comes and clarify these disputes. Like for example, they disputed among one another with regards to Isa alayhi salam, the son of Mary, whether he is a prophet or not. Like the people of Bani Israel, they denied the messengership of Isa, Jesus, the son of Mary. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran make it clear and confirm it that he is one of the great messengers of Allah. So clarifying that to them, so there's no excuse for them. Or those who claim to follow Isa alayhi salam when they had false beliefs about him, when they attributed some divine beliefs to him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clarified the matters for them that Isa alayhi salam is a messenger of Allah and a slave of Allah, not God himself, not the son of God, and so on. So the revelation from Allah comes and correct what people deviated away in and bring them back to the Sirat al-Mustaqim, to the straight path. So you got to know or taught what you did not know before that, you or your forefathers, your fathers and so on. And therefore people need to hold fast to the revelation from Allah. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قُلِ اللَّهِ, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah, that means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that brought down the books of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that brought down these books, and He's the one that sent the messengers. And that's what this is means, because some people, they take this part of the verse to think that it's okay to say Allah, 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 or to make dhikr like this. No, the Prophet ﷺ never made dhikr like that. This is an answer to what has been mentioned before. It's not an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just to say the name Allah, Allah, Allah like this, but this is answering what they have said of false and deviant beliefs, as it's mentioned in the verse. ثُمَّ ذَرْهُمْ فِي خَوْضِهِمْ يَلْعَبُونَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, ذَرْهُمْ, leave them playing in their falsehood that they are in what they indulged in as in evil. They leave them in their empty discourse, amusing themselves, right? This is of course not an order to leave them, that means to approve what they're doing. It's like when someone is arrogantly, stubbornly turning away from the truth, there's nothing else to be done after the matter has been made clear. So leave them. And of course, the Prophet ﷺ did the perfect job to convey the truth to the people. And he sacrificed and he did and put all the effort and fulfilled his job perfectly. And this is a warning for them when the truth is being presented to them and they reject it. And it shows that how human beings in this life, if they turn away from the revelation from Allah, they are empty, they have nothing. And that's why this is something that we should always be upon, that this life is nothing whatsoever. People are not upon anything. They are upon nothing. They are totally empty, unless people follow the revelation from Allah. Even if people are so sophisticated and materialistic knowledge, and they have so much power and so much wealth and so much establishments and so much ideas and perceptions and so on, it's all empty. Really, it's of no benefit whatsoever unless it has the foundation of the wahi, the revelation, the truth. Because otherwise, when a person dies and leaves all of these things behind, nothing is benefiting unless it's based on the revelation from Allah. Otherwise, people would regret everything that they did and they said and they contributed to this earth and to the people on the face of earth, unless it's for the sake of Allah, unless it's following the revelation from Allah, following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that's also even clearer in the next verses. So then next after that, verse number 92, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ مُصَدِّقُ الَّذِي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ وَلِتُنذِرَ أُمَّ الْقُرَى وَمَنْ حَوْلَهَا وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ وَهُمْ عَلَى صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. Which means, and this is a book which we have sent down, blessed and confirming what was before it, that you may warn the mother of cities and those around it, those who believe in the hereafter believe in it, and they are maintaining their prayers. وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ. And this is a book, which is the Qur'an. After the mention of the Torah in the previous verse, that it was revealed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and whoever deny the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed books to the messengers of Allah, they did not really believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did not appraise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way that he ought to be appraised. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honoring this book of Allah, the Quran, the best book ever revealed, the most perfect. And people can see that for their own selves. Whatever is left from the truth that is still present in the previous books, let them read these books and let them read the Quran. And this is a call for everyone. We're talking about everyone, meaning the non-Muslims. Muslims, alhamdulillah, we have sufficiency in the book of Allah. We don't need to go back and read in any other books. And this is something that the Prophet ﷺ, when he saw one time Umar radiallahu anhu with some pages of the Torah, and the Prophet ﷺ was upset. And he said to the people, are you in doubt? And he said that if Musa alayhi salam was to be alive now, he would follow me, follow the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That means there is nothing that we need to perfect the way that we live our life, to perfect the purpose of our life, unless it's in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. No need for us to seek guidance from anything else or any previous book. But for those who are upon something else, as a way for them to see even the truth, compare the books that you have and read it, and read the Quran, read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You would see how this book of Allah, there's nothing the like of it, even in its meanings and subjects, in the content of it, and of course linguistically in the Quran. It's a miraculous words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَا. This is a book to honor the book of Allah. أَنزَلْنَاهُ, we brought it down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought it down. مُبَارَكٌ, that means it's blessed. That means the goodness of it never ends, never ceases whatsoever. مُصَدِّقُ الَّذِي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ, confirming what was before it. So all of the books before, whatever in it of the truth is being present in the book of Allah, the Quran. Because if the one that brought them down, all of these books is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, therefore the meanings has to confirm one another. It won't contradict one another. And that's why it doesn't make sense that a prophet of Allah, that the book of Allah has been revealed to him, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and then the next book that was revealed would call the people to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means the one that sent the books are not the same. So the same thing, who's the one to be worshipped as it's mentioned in the Torah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who's the one to be worshipped in the Injil that was revealed to Isa alayhi salam? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. That he has no partners whatsoever. And the same thing with the Quran. But when people alter things, then the perfection and how things are and rulings and how to establish the worship of Allah and what's permissible, what's not permissible and so on, it's in the final revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it confirms what has been in the previous books. وَلِتُنذِرَ أُمَّ الْقُرَى وَمَنْ حَوْلَهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also to warn أُمَّ الْقُرَى. أُمَّ الْقُرَى means the mother of the cities, which is Mecca basically, and وَمَنْ حَوْلَهَا, and those who are around it, meaning all mankind. And the Prophet ﷺ called his people first, and those who are closer, and then closer, and so till the entire humanity, they are the ones to follow the Messenger ﷺ. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran more than one place, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we have not sent the Messenger ﷺ except as a mercy to all mankind. تبارك الذي نزل الفرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا. نذيرا is the same here as ولتنذر. That means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most exalted and the most blessed, that he sent, revealed the book, the Quran, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to be a warner to all that exists, human beings and jinn and so on. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is sent to all mankind, to the city of Mecca and what's around the city of Mecca and the entire earth. وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who believe in the hereafter, they believe in it. That means they believe in the Quran. They believe in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because if they truly believe in the hereafter, they would see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed his books to the messengers of Allah, and for them to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyone that is really have that sincerity, that they want to worship the creator of the heavens and the earth, they would never find it except in the Quran and in the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ, those who believe in the hereafter, they believe in it. And as the ulama, they say, this part of the verse is basically giving a deeper meaning here, or understanding to it, that those who do not believe in the Quran, they don't really believe in the hereafter. They're maybe trying to convince themselves, but if they truly believe in the hereafter, they will believe in the Quran. Because those who believe in the hereafter, they believe in the Quran. One of the pillars of Al-Iman, of course. And the Quran explains and talks about the hereafter like no other book before it, in detail, so much details about the hereafter, about the day of resurrection, about the Jannah, about the Hellfire. No book before the Quran talks about it in such an explicit and clear way. And this is by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ, and they are upon their salah, they are maintaining it. They are guarding their salah. This is the characteristics of the believers. Those who believe in the Quran, they guard their salah. And therefore, those who do not guard their salah, there is a problem with their matters of belief. So it has to be guarded, it has to be established. And that's why وَهُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. They're not just doing their salah, they are maintaining it. They're doing it in the most perfect way. They do the best they can to establish the salah according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered, according to the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So this verse praising the Quran, and it shows that it confirms what's before it in the books, and the belief of the hereafter, and how that the belief in the book of Allah and the belief in the hereafter, things go together. You cannot separate matters of belief. If somebody wants to live this life following one's desire, and they would say, we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's it. They don't want to follow anything. They don't want to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're contradicting themselves. Or those who would believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or claim that they believe in the hereafter, but they don't believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed anything to the human beings. That means they were left like this to be led astray, and not to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not to fulfill the purpose of their life. Then after that, the last verse for today, inshallah ta'ala, in this episode, verse number 93, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after mentioning about the books and revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the importance of that, then talking about those who would invent something or would claim and lie to be among those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to them, and that's one of the worst crimes ever. Verse number 93, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنِ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا أَوْ قَالَ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ وَلَمْ يُوحَ إِلَيْهِ شَيْءٍ وَمَنْ قَالَ سَأُنْزِلُ مِثْلَ مَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ وَلَوْ تَرَى إِذِ الظَّالِمُونَ فِي غَمَرَاتِ الْمَوْتِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ بَاسِطُوا أَيْدِيهِمْ أَخْرِجُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ الْيَوْمَ تُجْزَوْنَ عَذَابَ الْهُونِ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ غَيْرَ الْحَقِّ وَكُنْتُمْ عَنْ آيَاتِهِ تَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. Which means, and who is more unjust than one who invents a lie about Allah, who says it has been inspired to me, while nothing has been inspired to him, and one who says I will reveal something like what Allah revealed. And if you could but see, when the wrongdoers are in the overwhelming pangs of death, while the angels extend their hands, saying, "Discharge your souls. Today you will be awarded the punishment of extreme humiliation for what you used to say against Allah other than the truth, and that you were toward His verses being arrogant." So this is the verse that brings the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the heart, warning about the worst wrongdoing and in worst injustice whatsoever, and that is to state a lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to lie about the creator of the heavens and earth, or to claim that the person has been inspired or there is revelation that comes to him. These people that falsely claim to be messengers of Allah or prophets of Allah, and the Prophet ﷺ said that there will be 30 of them from the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ till the day of judgment. So warning against this, warning against this evil crime and evil wrongdoing. But we'll continue that and the lessons learned in these three verses right after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
يتدبرون القرآن أفلا يتدبرون القرآن
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Welcome back, and with verse number 93 from Surah Al-An'am. And after we read the verse and read the translation of the meanings of it, then going through the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying there is no one, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا, there is no one wrongdoer more than someone to lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to say that he has been inspired. That means revelation had been brought down to him, وَلَمْ يُوحَ إِلَيْهِ شَيْءٍ, and there is no revelation has been brought down to him whatsoever. So this is one of the worst things that a person can ever do or say. Even though this is mentioned about those who would claim to be prophets of Allah, but it also refers to what the root of this wrongdoing, and that is to mention a lie or to say a lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the worst sins that is basically the source for all sins and the source for even shirk and associating partners with Allah is to say about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowledge. As we said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not leave His creation like this, and therefore He sent messengers and revealed books. So there is no need for people to invent lies about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if there is no messengers of Allah, if there was no books, people would claim all kinds of things. And that's why those who claim that about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala certain things, and they would say the truth is this or the falsehood is this, or they would claim that they are being inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or Allah speaks to them. You know, anybody can say anything. And it's amazing that when people follow such individuals just for the fact that they are claiming something, that's foolishness, of course. So messengers of Allah, they are one after the other, they are brought to the truth to the people, confirming what every messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring to the people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not leave His creation like this with false messengers unless the matter becomes very clear. And those who would say, وَمَنْ قَالَ سَأُنزِلُ مِثْلَ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهِ, and those who would say that I would bring down the like of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought down, whether this is to specific individuals, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposed them, right? But the significance here is not about the names of these individuals, but rather the fact of the matter is that nobody is able to do anything. And that's the challenge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to all humanity, to bring the like of even one surah, not the entire Quran, just one surah, one chapter. And the smallest chapter of the Quran, you can fit it in one line. So they're not able to do that, and they will not be able to do so. So therefore they need to humble themselves. People need to say and to be clearly upon the truth and to follow the book of Allah, the Quran. And that's by the justice of Allah. The words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not just saying things as facts and that's it. But it's out of the mercy of Allah ordering the people to reflect and to think and to giving them and to give them the proper argument for them to see the truth without any doubt whatsoever. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, challenged them. And for those who claim these lies, there's nothing, no one is a wrongdoer more than them. They reach the maximum wrongdoing whatsoever when they would attribute a lie to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as a result of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning them and taking us in the verse as if we go to the hereafter to see what's going to happen to these individuals. وَلَوْ تَرَى إذ الظالمون في غمرات الموت. And if you could but see when the wrongdoers are in the overwhelming pangs of death. So this is in the last moments of the life, when the souls are being taken away from their bodies by the angels of, by the angel of death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, as if he's saying to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if you could see this, right? If people would see that, they would take a lesson, of course. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hid it from them so that they would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on the unseen. And for the believers to be content that no matter how much the wrongdoers are well established on the face of earth and they do things and they execute their evil doing and so on, this is all temporary. And if you would see them in the moment of death, you would really not value what they're doing now when they are in the state of health and so on. And they're all going to that direction. What happened to the tyrants before them? What happened to the wrongdoers before them? They all passed away. They all returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all of their evil doing, their actions stayed in their deeds, and themselves and the power that they were seeking and all of that is gone with their death. And that's the lesson that a person of intellect would take. وَلَوْ تَرَى إِذِ الظَّالِمُونَ. So الظَّالِمُونَ, the wrongdoers. فِي غَمَرَاتِ الْمَوْتِ, the pangs of death. Death has pangs, or stubborns as they call it. And the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ الْمَوْتِ سَكَرَاتِ, that death has sakarat to it. Has tough times for everybody that when they face death. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all of us and to make us among those who return to the mercy of Allah. So the wrongdoers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that if you would see them, وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ بَاسِطُ أَيْدِيهِمْ, and the angels are extending their hands to them to take their souls. أَخْرِجُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, the angels would say to them, discharge your souls. And the Prophet ﷺ explained in the hadith how the souls of the disbelievers are really being snatched away from their body in such a painful way because of their evil doings, when the angel of death comes down and the angels of punishment comes down with him. So the angels would extend their hands for them, for these wrongdoers, for their souls to come out. اليوم تجزون عذاب الهون, on that day, تجزون عذاب الهون, you will be awarded the punishment of extreme humiliation. تجزون from الجزاء, recompensed because of their actions. Of course, it's not a reward. It's they would receive the result of their actions. This life is the life of action, and the reward and the punishment and the justice and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. And that starts from the moment of death. And that's why this is an evidence also with regards to the punishment in the grave. That in the grave it's either punishment or delight, and not just in the hereafter. So because it says al-yawma after the mention of the death, it says al-yawm, today, right after they die, they will be awarded عذاب الهون, the punishment of humiliation. So they are punished physically and non-physical punishment, the humiliation of the punishment. Why is that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ غَيْرَ الْحَقِّ, because of what you used to say about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is not the truth. So they did it to themselves. وَكُنْتُمْ عَنْ آيَاتِي تَسْتَكْبِرُونَ, and you were away from the signs of Allah arrogantly are being mentioned in these verses. People are not punished because of their names, because of their fathers, because of the raid that they were in. They won't be punished because of that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just, not like other human beings. The human beings, they would punish even one another based on things that they didn't do in their life, just because of they are from different race or different place or whatever there is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the humiliation of the punishment that is humiliating will be because of what? Because they said about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala other than the truth. They said lies about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned them. And the arrogance that made them stay away from the signs of Allah. Signs from Allah, that means it's very clear. It is very clear and it's very obvious, and it addresses the innate of the person and the fitrah of the person. So when a person turns away from that, he's not turned away because he does not see that this is the truth. It's because of arrogance that is present in the heart. وَكُنْتُمْ عَنْ آيَاتِهِ تَسْتَكْبِرُونَ, as even the verses after that will talk about more of what's going to happen to them in the day of resurrection. But when we see these three verses and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His mercy, He's making the matter so clear to the disbelievers and warning them and taking them with the words of the verses to the hereafter to see in the moment of death, so that people would not say that we were not warned. And as we heard it many times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us in such a way that we understand very well how it is when we are warned of something, especially when it comes from a trustworthy source. People take warnings very serious, but it seems like many human beings, because of the really not truthful, and because of arrogance, they're not taking these warnings seriously, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning them that this is going to happen to them at the moment of death, because of the lies that they said about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and because of their arrogance that made them turn away from the signs of Allah. So therefore, the book of Allah, the Quran, when people are turning away from it, turning away from the truth, turning away from that truth to be presented to them, it's because of the arrogance, it's because of the lies that they invented. And therefore, when we look again through these verses, it all goes into really people did not appraise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way that He ought to be appraised subhanahu wa ta'ala. If people have this in their hearts, exalting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeing and witnessing the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would never live their life following their desires and just doing whatever they want to do on the face of earth without thinking that there's a wisdom behind their creation, without them worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of that, they underestimate the power of Allah. And the same thing with the level of sins. When people commit sins, we should also remember that a person knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching him, and he continued to commit sins and disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. If a person repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the repentance. But this is how the hearts of the believers should be full of the exaltation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and having this matter of belief with the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to be away from these evil characteristics that are mentioned in these verses. We need to, the verses talks about the belief in the pillars of Al-Iman, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the belief in the books is mentioned in these verses, the belief of the messengers of Allah, the belief of the hereafter is mentioned, the belief of the angels is mentioned. So, and basically the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the sixth pillar of Al-Iman. So to believe in the pillars of Al-Iman, to believe in all of the messengers of Allah, and that the messengers of Allah, people are in need of them, because that's the thing between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believe in some of the books of Allah, like At-Tawrah, like the Injil, and the best book of course is the book of Allah, the Quran, that these books were light and guidance, and without the books of Allah, people are in total darkness and they are deviated, and people will deviate from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to how they turn away from it. Also, it warns against those who would take parts of the book and leave other parts of the book. That's how the people of Bani Israel, they did that from the previous books. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted them with saving the book, but they betrayed this trust. But as for this ummah, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised to preserve the revelation from Allah. Nobody can really change it and it stays to be changed. Rather, it's going to be always on the, you know, the truth is there, the purity of the final revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter what human beings they try to do, the truth will continue to be there because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved it in the hearts of the believers. So the danger of taking parts of the book and leaving parts of the book, how can we apply this in our life? To take the deen of Al-Islam in its totality, in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, the way of the early generations of Al-Islam, and not to take parts of the deen and leave other parts of the deen, or what fits our culture and what doesn't fit our culture, for example, then we leave it. If people are living among those who would drink alcohol and so on, then they would leave this part of the deen of Al-Islam. No, it's not permissible. Or people that are living in among others, those who, their women, for example, they don't wear hijab, so they would continue to be like them. This is not how deen is. A deen, a person makes a person patient to be obedient to Allah and to endure this patient and to seek rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, one of the great benefits that we learned, that the more people are not following the revelation from Allah, that means they are playing in this life, that their life is of no value whatsoever, that the life is empty, Life is empty without the worship of Allah. Life is empty without the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The verses talks about how the Quran being the best book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, confirming the previous books, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Quran to all mankind, and that those who believe in the hereafter, they believe in the book of Allah. The importance of the salah, so this is the pillars of Islam, and to guard them and to continuously pray and so on. Also the great benefits about what dhulm is, what injustice is when people would claim lies about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or denying the revelation from Allah. And the verse also talks about the hereafter, so the belief in the hereafter, the moment of death, the belief that there's a punishment in the grave, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, because of people saying lies about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and arrogantly turning away from the signs of Allah. There are great lessons, and it all comes down to the fact that if we exalt and appraise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way He ought to be subhanahu wa ta'ala, and submit ourselves to the orders of Allah and worship Him alone, then these are the means of steadfastness and guidance. Wa sallallahu sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Afala yatadabbaruna al-Qur'an
walau kana min 'indi ghayrillahi lawajadu fihi ikhtilafan kathira.
Afala yatadabbaruna al-Qur'an ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا. يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه